The nation's chief law enforcement officer said today it is time to scale back tough prison terms for low-level drug crimes. He announced he is changing the way federal prosecutors go after small fry offenders. The United States is home to just 5% of all the people on Earth, but accounts for more than a quarter of the world's prison population, more than 2.2 million people.
Too many Americans go to too many prisons for far too long and for no truly good law enforcement reason.
Today in San Francisco, the U.S. Attorney General said that number must come down. Eric Holder addressed the American Bar Association's annual meeting.
Although incarceration has a significant role to play in our justice system, widespread incarceration at the federal, state, and local levels is both ineffective and unsustainable. It imposes a significant economic burden, totaling $80 billion in 2010 alone. And it comes with human and moral costs that are impossible to calculate. As a nation, we are coldly efficient in our incarceration efforts. And with an outsized, unnecessarily large prison population, we need to ensure that incarceration is used to punish, to deter, and to rehabilitate, but not merely to warehouse and to forget.
One step toward a solution, according to Holder, scale back mandatory minimum sentences for low-level nonviolent drug offenses. There are almost 220,000 prisoners in federal penitentiaries now, 40% over capacity. Nearly half of those inmates are serving time for drug-related crimes. Holder plans to tell federal prosecutors to change the way they handle those cases.
They now will be charged with offenses for which the accompanying sentences are better suited to their individual conduct rather than excessive prison terms more appropriate for violent criminals or drug kingpins.
The Attorney General wants states to do likewise, given that 225,000 people are serving time in state prisons for drug crimes. There is longstanding bipartisan support for such reform. U.S. Senator Richard Durbin of Illinois has introduced the Smarter Sentencing Act, co-sponsored by fellow Democrat Patrick Leahy of Vermont and Republican Mike Lee of Utah. Kentucky Republican Rand Paul also has a measure to increase judicial discretion. Durbin wrote the law that ended a long-standing disparity in drug sentencing that hit minorities hardest. The president signed it in 2010.
A bipartisan bill to help right a long-standing wrong by narrowing sentencing disparities between those convicted of crack cocaine and powder cocaine. It's the right thing to do.
Today, Holder also cited the toll such harsh sentences take on some American communities.
And let's be honest, some of the enforcement priorities that we have set have had a destabilizing effect on particular communities, largely poor and of color. And applied inappropriately, they are ultimately counterproductive.
Holder added that programs to enable compassionate release for older inmates and to send drug offenders to rehab, not up the river, should help trim prison populations.
To examine the arguments on each side of the issue, we turn to Mary Price. She's vice president and general counsel of Families Against Mandatory Minimums. That's an advocacy group. And William Otis. He's adjunct professor at Georgetown Law School and former special counsel to President George H.W. Bush. Welcome to you both to the NewsHour. Mary Price, let me start with you. You think these changes are a good idea. Why?
Absolutely. Our criminal justice system has become addicted to solving our social and public safety problems with incarceration. Today, Eric Holder said the department recognizes that and says that we have to step away from using those kinds of policies. We can't incarcerate our way to public safety, and nor given the inequities, as he pointed out, should we do that. So I think today it's significant. What he's saying is that with more flexibility in sentencing, we can be actually safer. And I think that that's very important and something that we absolutely support.
So your argument is that there's less crime?
Sure. Our argument is that we're locking up too many of the wrong kind of people for too long for the wrong kinds of crimes. Certainly, I mean, people who we are afraid of, people who are committing serious crimes, they ought to be incarcerated. We need to be kept safe. But as he pointed out, half of the people that we're incarcerating are in federal prison for drug crimes, and a significant proportion of them are nonviolent and low-level offenders. We cannot continue to spend the kind of the amount of our criminal justice dollars on locking up people while the Department of Justice goes looking for money for real public safety reforms.
William Otis, what's your take on these changes?
I think the Attorney General is making some mistakes. Your segment started out by pointing out that he said that our criminal justice system is ineffective and unsustainable. It is very costly. No one doubts that. Any major social program that aims to increase public safety is going to be costly. The Attorney General saying that it's ineffective, I think, is just not so and paints a misleading picture of what our criminal justice system has done. It omits the fact that far from being the failure that he portrayed, our criminal justice system over the last 20 years has reduced the crime rate by 50%. That is not a picture of a failure, it's a picture of a success. Now, it's true that...
And you're saying that's largely due to these mandatory minimum sentences?
It's due in significant part to the fact that we are incarcerating more people and incarcerating them for longer. Now, it's not due solely to that. Of course, there are other measures, increased hiring of police, more effective police work, more effective private security measures also contribute to that. But imprisonment has significantly helped bring about this enormous drop in the crime rate.
Mary Price, what about that?
But if there were that kind of a link, you would think that when mandatory minimums and over-incarceration policies were adopted, that crime would go down, and when they were abandoned, that crime would go up. But in fact, recently, the Pew Center on the States found that of the 17 states that had reduced their reliance on over-incarceration, their crime rates did not go up. So there's not such a direct link, and this led conservatives from a group called Right on Crime to say, no, this is not the kind of relationship that we can rely on.
What
and
about
in fact, we can reduce incarceration and keep ourselves safe at the same time by using our criminal justice dollars much, much more wisely.
Excuse me, William Otis, what about one of the other arguments the Attorney General made that the prison population, it wasn't the only argument, but one of them certainly is that the prison population way, way overcrowded, and that this will be a way to get minor offenders into alternative programs where they can be rehabilitated among
other things. I think anyone would want criminals to be rehabilitated, and there are programs in prison, particularly in federal prison, that aim to do that because most criminals, after all, will be back on the street at one point or another. Where I think the Attorney General missed the ball was in concentrating on the 0.75% of the population that's in prison, but never mentioning the 99% who are not and whose safety has been so significantly improved, again, in part because of increased incarceration. I think another problem that the attorney...
Well, let me just pick up on that. So you're saying that by focusing just on those who are in prison and not on those who didn't get caught, in other words.
It's that, and it's more than that, that people who have not been crime victims on account of the strong measures that we have taken to prevent crime and to bring crime down, those people count too. That they have not been victims have saved them money, and that's money that counts in the public fisc as well.
You want to quickly respond?
Well, I mean, I think that punishment is important in certain cases. What the Attorney General is focusing on are not he's not going to be releasing violent criminals or not charging them appropriately. What he's saying is that we can be smarter about the people that we lock up for lengthy periods of time under mandatory minimum sentences. This is a smart on crime move. He's the top law enforcement officer in the country. His job on a day-to-day basis is to keep us safe. He would not be taking these measures if he thought that doing so would not keep us safe.
One of the other arguments I was reading today William Otis, is that what the Attorney General is not changing the law. The laws that require mandatory minimum sentences are still on the books. The people now in prison who received those sentences will remain in prison. These are future offenders. So will this have much of an effect at all is the question.
I think you make a very good point. The Attorney General's remarks today actually, I think, seem to be more than they are. At present, federal law contains two safety valves that already offer an opportunity for leniency and for offenders to go below mandatory minimums. One of those has some of the criteria the Attorney General outlined today. They allow offenders who otherwise would be subject to mandatory minimums to get out of that if they are not violent, if they still...
So you're saying that, you're saying that the method is already there, the ability to make these changes.
It's already there, and as a matter of fact, it's frequently used in federal court.
But what about this point about this doesn't change the law? It's still on the books.
Exactly. It doesn't change the law. And the safety valve to which Bill is referring is terrific. I mean, 80,000 people have benefited with shorter sentences over the years, but it's not enough. Clearly, our prisons are way oversubscribed. We're operating at 140% capacity. What the Attorney General is saying is, Congress, the ball is in your court. He made reference to several bipartisan bills that would reduce mandatory minimums or provide larger safety valves to them. And he said, we're going to take the first step. We're demonstrating what we can do to reduce the reliance on over-incarceration, and we're going to reach out a hand to Congress, and we're going to work with Congress.
We're going to leave it there for tonight. Mary Price, William Otis, we thank you both.
Thank you so much.
You can watch the rest of the Attorney General's speech on our website.